हेलो दीपाली,
यस मैम।
हैज सर जॉइन? आर यू
नो,
एबल टू
नॉट
सी?
येट, नॉट येट मैम।
ओके, आई विल ट्राई टू कॉन्टैक्ट हिम इफ ही हैज एनी डिफिकल्टी। हाय
ओके मैम।
ब्लेंडा,
गुड मॉर्निंग, गुड मॉर्निंग कृष्ण प्रिया, गुड मॉर्निंग।
यस यस, वेटिंग फॉर द लेक्चर।
Yeah, I'm also waiting for sir. I'll just try to contact
Okay,
him.
okay.
I think sir is there.
Yeah, ma'am, he just joined.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, Hosur sir. So you need to unmute yourself. We are not able to hear you, sir.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, okay.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning,
sir. We
Dolly.
would like to see the connectivity of your device once again before we begin.
Yes, right. So I should put my PowerPoint file, isn't it? The
yes,
screen
sir.
says
yes,
screen sharing, no? Before that? I should
yes,
say.
Sir. Yes, sir. We can see you. Yeah, your video and your audio is perfect.
Screen share, where is that thing now? So
sir, there is a square box which has an upward arrow.
Ah, upward, yeah, that's right.
And
screen share, yes.
Share full screen, sir.
So you can see it? You can see my screen?
No, sir.
Not yet, sir.
Share. Okay. Can you see? But I have not shared any screen.
Ah.
I shared the screen, but
Now you can put the PowerPoint.
Yes, your full screen is there. So we can see your full screen. I'll just select your PowerPoint. Yes.
Yeah. So this is what it is.
Yes.
Sir, slideshow.
You can see it.
Yes, sir. Just make it full screen, sir.
Full screen. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Perfect, sir. Perfect. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now
sir,
we are.
I just request you to stop sharing the screen, and once we begin the program, we will request you to start sharing the screen.
So now I stop it. Stop.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Well, good morning everyone, and welcome to day 3 of revisiting different facets of medicinal chemistry. So after having an exciting 2 days on heavy chemistry, lead discoveries, methods which we understood how to identify impurities, quantify them, understand their toxicities, we have another insightful day where we are going to closely look at a most important thing in drug discovery, is how the macromolecules work in great detail. We can, today's techniques are such that we'll be able to look in very great detail about these biomacromolecules and their interactions with drug molecules, small molecules, substrate molecules, and so on and so forth. So the theme for today is advances in nuclear magnetic resonance, mass spectrometry, and X-ray crystallography. NMR is an integral component of drug discovery process, and applications all the way from hit discovery to late stage development. It has been routinely used for fragment-based screening of ligand for ligand affinity, high resolution protein structure determination, and rapid protein ligand co-crystal modeling. Multi-dimensional NMR techniques with various pulse sequences harness different information that enhance structural and dynamical information of biomacromolecular systems. Because of its inherent versatility, NMR currently is making great strides in contributing towards expanding the field of metabolomics, where it has successfully been used to identify biomarkers for various diseases, to analyze drug toxicities, and to determine a drug's in vivo efficacy and selectivity. Further, we have mass spectrometry, which has been used for profiling and identifying metabolites. It's a key step in supporting the drug discovery and development of novel chemical entities. Metabolite identification studies are helping us understand the clearance mechanisms, parse the presence of potential active and reactive metabolites, and observe the disproportionate or unique metabolites to better understand the molecule's biotransformation capabilities. For all the molecular modeling and computational people, structure, high-resolution protein structures has been an immense tool to understand how to design new drugs, and 3D structures of biomolecules are particularly those determined by X-ray crystallography, often considered as gold standard of data describing the molecular architecture of important proteins, nucleic acids, and etc. X-ray crystallography has been the primary method for determining the three-dimensional structure of protein, nucleic acid, and viruses, and the method is over 100 years old now. Structural information have paved way for structure-guided drug discovery and laid the foundation for structural bioinformatics. It can provide structures of high resolution until atomic details and detailed experimental evidence of binding modes of small molecules, and to so extent that we can also find out the placement of the exact placement of water molecules. With big data paradigm, nuclear magnetic resonance, mass spectrometry, and crystallography have become important tools for processing the structural information, combined with functional and other experimental and bioinformatics studies. Today's session will provide insights on different analytical techniques used for development and discovery of new molecules. With this, I would like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Hosur. Welcome, sir, and good morning. So it's been a pleasure to introduce Professor Hosur, which is almost a household name in nuclear magnetic resonance community in India. Professor Hosur is currently the Raja Ramanna Fellow of University of Mumbai, Department of Atomic Energy, Center of Excellence for Basic Sciences, and a distinguished visiting professor at Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering at IIT Bombay. Professor Hosur completed his BSc from Karnataka in 1971, after which he pursued his MSc in Chemistry from IIT Bombay, which he completed in 1973. He earned his PhD in chemistry from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai, which is fondly called as TIFR, in 1978. In 1981, he worked as a postdoc fellow specializing in NMR techniques at Etihad Zurich in the groups of Nobel laureates Professor Kurt Wuttrich, Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2002, and Richard Ernst, Nobel Prize in Chemistry 1991. Professor Hosur joined TIFR as a research associate in 1978 and retired as a senior professor grade I in 2018. In 2017, he was appointed as a director of University of Mumbai Department of Atomic Energy, Center of Excellence for Basic Sciences, and later as a visiting professor. And in 2019, he was awarded the Raja Ramanna Fellowship by the Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. Also in 2018, he became the honorary professor at the Department of Biophysics, University of Mumbai, and a distinguished visiting professor at IIT Bombay. Professor Hosur was the convener of the National Facility for High Field NMR at TIFR Mumbai from 2002 until his retirement in 2018. He has been the recipient of several awards, and I will read out a few of them because in interest of time. An honorary mention for the excellent lecture notes at an international summer school on quantum chemistry held in Uppsala in Sweden and in Norway, 1975. Young Scientist Award by Bruker NMR Company in 1983. Young Scientist Medal by Indian National Academy, Science Academy in 1984. Third Annual Award by Society of Cancer Research in 1998. J.C. Bose National Fellowship by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India in 2007. Professor G.N. Ramachandran Gold Medal by CSIR in 2009. The Padma Shri by the Honorable President of India in 2014. The Distinguished Alumnus Award by IIT Bombay in 2015. He is also associated and has been given awarded fellowship for many world-renowned academies like Young Associate, Indian Academy of Sciences in 1985 until 1988, Fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences 1994, Fellow of the Indian National Science Academy 1995, Fellow of the World Academy of Sciences in 2008, Fellow of the International Society of Magnetic Resonance in 2017. Professor Husu's major research interests are at the interface of physics, chemistry, and biology, and particularly in NMR techniques and their applications in solving the structure, dynamics, and interaction of biomacromolecules. He has published over 250 research papers, 3 books, 3 review articles, 3 book reviews, and 3 technical reviews. With this, I welcome you, sir. The stage is all yours.
Sir, we can't hear you.
Professor Husu, can you hear us?
Sir is muted. Elvis.
Yeah. Hello, sir.
I'll try to get in touch with him.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, is it fine now?
Yes, sir, perfectly fine.
Okay, so now I will share the screen again. The screen is already there?
Yes, no, sir, not yet.
Yeah, is it sharing now?
Yes, sir.
And where is my presentation?
Sir, below.
Okay, is that fine?
Yes, sir, perfect. Thank you.
Okay, all right. Okay, so okay, let me say again what I said earlier. Thank you very much for your kind introduction. And let me also thank Dr. Premlata Amre for inviting me to this workshop. I believe this is meant for teachers and faculty of the colleges and universities. So the person who introduced me actually made a very nice summary of the whole workshop and intended things for today. I was just wondering at what level I should pitch it. It looks like I actually pitched it at the appropriate level. So this is slightly at a higher, not appropriate for the students per se, but is okay for the teachers and researchers. So therefore, I'm going to start with the introduction of the NMR techniques. And I'm sorry, I actually changed my lecture slightly compared to what I had sent about 10 days ago. So yesterday I made those changes. I've sent the copies of that to Dr. Premlata also again. So I'm going to follow that because I added on some things which relate to the herbal products, so which is direct relevance to medicinal chemistry. So therefore I made that change. Okay. So now let us see, there are two components to this lecture. One is the techniques, especially NMR techniques, and then of course we go to the applications. First, we'll begin with the techniques. To give it just a summary of the developments that have happened in the NMR techniques front, it was discovered in 1946 in the solution phase. And then, of course, various discoveries happened in the ensuing years, chemical shift coupling constants over Hauser effects by NACO. And for the basic discovery in 1946, there was a Nobel Prize shared by Felix Bloch and Purcell in 1952. And the various other developments happened, like spin decoupling, cross-polarization. Cross-polarization is basically used in the solid-state NMR. And then 1966 was a major revolution in the NMR development. That was Fourier transform NMR. In fact, we are going to start there today from Fourier transform NMR. And then we have a two-dimensional NMR. NMR imaging is a parallel development in other fields in medicine, especially. Most people know about NMR imaging, call them as MRI. And then 1985 onwards, there was a big boom again. There is multidimensional NMR. Then you have multiple receivers, non-uniform sampling, pure shift NMR, NMR super sequences, so on and so on and so forth. Continues. It continues unabated. So we'll try and give a glimpse of all these developments in a way that people can comprehend the principles there or the applications there. And then you can also see that this 1991 Nobel Prize in Chemistry was given to Richard Ernst for this developments in Fourier transform NMR and his contribution to two-dimensional NMR and also NMR imaging. Fourier imaging was developed by him. So a Nobel Prize in Chemistry was again given in 2002 to Kurt Wittrich for the development in biomolecular NMR, protein structures, nucleic acid structures, and so on. Until then, nobody would think about doing anything beyond 10 atoms, 15 atoms, or that sort of molecules. So dipeptide, tripeptide were the things which were the limiting molecules. But then, of course, with this development, it went up to proteins. And now today, we think of proteins of 30 kD, 50 kD, and things like that. And then the parallel development of imaging won the Nobel Prize in 2003 two people, Paul Lauterbur and Peter Mansfield. Okay, so here are the pictures of these people. And of course, the 43, 44, I did not speak about. These were the physicists who actually invented nuclear magnetic moment, 1943, with his own Stern. And then Rabi, who actually discovered NMR in the gas phase in 1944. And these were the years of the Nobel Prize. They discovered them much earlier. They were in 1936, 37, something like that. And I've mentioned about 1952, Felix Bloch and Purcell, they actually discovered this in the solution phase. That is where most of chemistry and biology lies. And 1991 and 2002, I mentioned here, this were for the chemistry in Fourier terms of NMR and biomolecular NMR. Peter Mansfield and Paul Lauterbur, these were for the imaging. This one I should hide. This in between the bottom thing actually comes is the nuisance, no? I will hide this. Okay. Now here is a picture taken when these both people visited TIFR sometime in 1990s, I think. We had an NMR conference and both these people had come, Wittrich and Richard Ernst. I blocked them there. So this was a wonderful NMR workshop. And this workshop was attended by so many people, as you can see over there. Okay, now so we begin at Fourier transform NMR. We don't begin with the first discovery because that is already covered in probably already known to most of you people, the teachers, and even this would be known, but it's a good idea to recapitulate these things because it leads to two-dimensional and multi-dimensional NMR techniques. Fourier transform NMR was a major revolution in NMR because it introduced the concept of pulsed excitation, which means you actually excite large number of nuclei spins at the same time by applying the radio frequency for a small pulse. Now, let me see if we can get the cursor. Somebody, if you had shown me how to get the cursor there.
Sir, can you just, show the
Linear pointer, yes.
Sir, no, one below.
This is the one, right? This
pointer
is okay?
Option. Yes, sir, that's fine.
Okay, now this is the pulse. The pulse means you start the radio frequency. Your radio frequency is put on and then you put it on for a short time, something like about period of 5 microseconds, and then you switch it off. The result of this will be, this is the time domain here. Along this axis, we have the time. And if you Fourier transform this, it will result in a frequency domain, and the frequencies cover this whole range here. So if this is the frequency of your RF, which you are applying here, omega naught, then it will generate this switching on and switching off process. It will generate a whole range of frequencies, and that is represented by the Fourier transform of this time domain function into the frequency domain. So you have this whole range of frequencies. You notice here, this comes to zero at 1 by tau, and this is again 1 by tau. So if tau is of the order of 10 microseconds, this will be 10 to the power 5, and this is also 10 to the power 5. That is 100 kilohertz. So it covers a whole range of 200 kilohertz from here to here. However, we don't use all of this. What we will use is the small portion here on the top, which may be about some 15, 20 kilohertz. And that is enough for our excitation of your NMR frequencies in your sample. If you have a proton spectrum, typically 0 to 10 ppm or 12 ppm. So if you are working at, let us say, 500 megahertz, that amounts to 6,000 hertz. If you are working at 700 megahertz, then it will work out to be like 7,000 hertz. So typically this range is enough for us to excite all these frequencies in one go. So if you apply for 10 microseconds, you excite all the frequencies in one go. Unlike in the previous methods of slow passage, you scan them one by one, that will take several hours to complete the entire spectrum. So here in one go, with 10 microsecond pulse, you excite all the frequencies in this range. So now then what happens? The pulse also has, when you apply this short period RF, then that is also called as a pulse. If that period is tau, then what happens is the magnetization of the entire spin system, which is normally along the z-axis, gets rotated into the transverse plane. That is called as the flip angle. So because of this pulse, the RF, it results in the rotation of the magnetization away from the z-axis into the transverse plane. Then we say if the magnetization comes along the y-axis, then we say we apply a 90-degree pulse along the y-axis. If it comes onto the y-axis, then we say the magnetization, the pulse has been applied along the x-axis. So it is a 90-degree rotation. So flip angle is a 90-degree here. So when we do that, so magnetization is now in the transverse plane. So after that, there is no perturbation because we have removed the RF. So when there is no perturbation, the system will have to go back to equilibrium. The magnetization has to recover back to the z-axis. And this is how it does. So if you take this example here, your initial magnetization of two spins, which are along the z-axis, you apply the 90x pulse and it is rotated onto the y-axis. So therefore, this contains the magnetization components of the two spins, let's say K and L, and the total is IY here. So this is the Y magnetization. Now, during the next period, this magnetization has to recover back to the z-axis. So this will do so while processing along the z-axis, around the z-axis, then recovering back to the z-axis. When it is moving, the magnetization is moving in the transverse plane, it induces a voltage in the receiver, which is put here, and that is your observed signal. So that is actually time domain and signal. And if you plot it as a function of time, you can see here both these individual spins K and L produce an oscillating time domain function. And this is called as the sum of these is called as your FID. This decays here because the magnetization components in the transverse plane decays. Therefore, this will last for about 100 to 200 milliseconds. So you collect the time domain data as a superposition of all these various frequencies. And then when you Fourier transform this, this generates a function f of t. When you Fourier transform this, you get a frequency domain spectrum again. Now this frequency domain spectrum function will contain only those frequencies which are present in the FID. So that is how you unravel the frequencies present in your molecule. So this is the principle of Fourier transform NMR. You see now what is the gain? This is the conventional NMR spectrum which is recorded in about 500 seconds. This is one scan by the continuous wave method where the frequency is scanned through the spectrum and whenever there is a resonance, you get a peak. Whereas in the same 500 seconds, the Fourier transform NMR produced a spectrum like this. To look at the signal to noise gain here. So this therefore is a major revolution with regard to the sensitivity of the NMR spectroscopy. Otherwise, actually NMR is a relatively insensitive technique compared to optical spectroscopy, things like fluorescence spectroscopy, absorption spectroscopy, etc. Therefore, you needed to have large amount of molecule, large amount of samples, which often may not be available. Therefore, the applications were relatively limited in the before this discovery. So with this discovery, the Fourier transform NMR, it became applicable to many, many different kinds of systems. And therefore, this is called as the first NMR revolution after the discovery, after the basic discovery. And therefore, now you can also go down to smaller sample sizes. Like instead of having half a molar sample, you can go to millimolar samples. And then you can also look at rare nuclei such as carbon-13, nitrogen-15, which you cannot normally observe in the case of the continuous wave NMR. And Fourier transform NMR, you can do signal averaging relatively faster because you can collect 500 scans. Why is the signal gain here? Because in one scan, you collect the entire FID. You do it 500 times. Therefore, your signal to noise gain is by under root 500. Therefore, you get that many signal to noise, that much of signal to noise gain. Because if you add n number of scans, your signal to noise gain is factor of root n. And therefore, you have a substantial gain in the signal to noise. You can go down to rare nuclei like carbon-13 and N15, which have a natural abundance of 1.1% and 0.37% respectively. Therefore, you can observe the signals of these using Fourier transform NMR. And this was published by Richard Ernst in 1966 in the Reviews of Scientific Instruments. And the Richard Ernst actually many of you may know that he passed away at the age of 89. And he has, we had the good fortune of interacting with him. And he used to tell us that this paper was rejected by Journal of Chemical Physics twice because nobody understood this. The people felt that, okay, there is something wrong here. Your sample may not be pure and things like that. What you are getting is not the spectrum of the molecule, but something else. But however, after the analysis, they discovered that it is indeed the same molecule spectrum. And therefore, this gain is real. And therefore, and that actually laid the, as I said, the foundation for major developments later on. And this actually laid the foundation for two-dimensional NMR as well. Because the Fourier transform NMR showed us that excitation and detection are separated in time. In what you do in the Fourier transform NMR, you apply a short pulse of 10 microseconds, and when you're collecting the data, you are doing nothing. Therefore, the excitation and detection of the signal are separated in time. Excitation of the spin system and detection of the signal are separated in time. If that is the case, then you can also do so many other manipulations. Because in the FID, no matter where you actually start collecting the data, all the information about the frequencies and the intensities are present. Therefore, we don't lose anything there if you delay the acquisition by a certain amount of time. So this led to this new idea called as the segmentation of the time axis. So here is, this is the time axis running from left to right. So you have the preparation, which can be in any, whatever way it is, it may be just a delay also, or you prepare the molecules or spins in a particular state, and then you allow them to evolve for a certain period of time. You don't actually collect the data during this time. Then you introduce a certain other period called as mixing, which actually mixes up the magnetization components of the individual spins. And then you collect the data in during the time T2, and this is called as the detection period. Now you do this experiment repeatedly by changing the T1 value systematically. So here the T1 starts from zero time, and then you have 100 microseconds, 200 microseconds, 300 microseconds, and so on and so forth. You continuously increment it, collect FIDs each time. Each time that as a function of time T2, you collect the data, that is one FID. Therefore, if you do this experiment 500 times, then you will have 500 FIDs here. So therefore, you generate a two-dimensional time domain data, which is represented as S, T1, T2, and this is an independent time variable. This T1 is independently varied, and T2 is again a time variable which is used for the Fourier transformation, normally in the one-dimensional NMR. Therefore, if this is an independent time variable, you can also do a Fourier transformation along this axis, which will generate a spectrum, another frequency dimension. Therefore, you do a two-dimensional Fourier transformation here. You generate a two-dimensional frequency domain spectrum. You represent this as F1 and F2. Okay, so these were the two breakthroughs which are created by Richard Ernst, which are published in 1976 and 79 respectively. And one of them is called as the COSY. This is called 2D correlation spectroscopy. One of them is called COSY, other one is called NOSY. They are both correlated spectra. However, they correlate different things. In the COSY, you correlate two spins which are J-coupled. In NOSY, you correlate two spins which are coupled by dipolar interaction, that is through space interaction. But these are important information. Okay, now here is, for example, a correlated two-dimensional schematic of a two-dimensional spectrum. You have this a two-line spectrum, one-dimensional spectrum here. And along the two frequency axis, if the frequency is the same, it results a peak here. And similarly, it results a peak here. If along the two axis, if the frequency is the same. But if along the two axis, you can also have different frequencies because of mixing. As I said, the mixing period which was given in the schematic, because of the mixing of the two spins, you might generate another frequency along the T2 dimension, starting from a frequency of the A spin. For example, if in the A spin in the T1 dimension, you have this frequency of omega A, then because of the mixing, some of it of this magnetization goes to the B spin. Therefore, during the T2 period, you will have two frequencies, omega A and omega B, and these are originating from omega A in the T1 dimension. Similarly, in the T1 dimension, if you have omega B, then you can generate two frequencies in the T2 period, omega B and omega A. So therefore, this transfer results in the so-called cross peak, and this will tell you that these two frequencies are, two distances are correlated in some manner. It may be a J correlation, or it can be a distant dipolar correlation. Depending upon which is the correlation, you have a different kind of a 2D spectrum. So here is the simple pulse sequence for a COSY experiment, which correlates J coupling information. Okay, so you have one 90 degree pulse here, and the T1 period, a second 90 degree pulse, and you collect the FID in the time T2. So you collect several FIDs there, and then you do Fourier transformation, you generate a two-dimensional spectrum, COSY spectrum. So here is the schematic of this COSY spectrum of this particular molecule. This is a dipeptide here, NH, C alpha, CO, NH, C alpha, CO that goes next way. So, and this is one amino acid here. This is the valine amino acid. You have the NH. Okay, now we are looking at the proton correlation, the proton-proton. Now you see here, this proton is J coupled to this proton, and this proton is J coupled to this proton, and these two are J coupled to this, and this is also J coupled to these two methyl protons. Okay, so this is the J coupling information. So now therefore, let us look at this here. The NH proton is producing a cross peak to the alpha proton here, and the alpha proton produces a cross peak to the beta proton here, and the beta proton produces the cross peaks to the two methyls here. Okay, but you see, the and those are the two gammas, and there is no cross peak between the two gammas because the two gamma methyls are not, they are not J coupled. Their coupling constant is very small. Only when there is a reasonable coupling, you will see these cross peaks. Therefore, by looking at this pattern of these cross peaks here, you can figure out that this is a valine molecule, okay, valine amino acid residue. So that is the important thing. Now, this solid arrow that is indicated by this dashed envelope here, so it is showing or whichever ones are J coupled are connected by the dashed lines. And the solid lines which are there, these are actually indicating the distance correlations. Okay, distance correlation is if they are close by in space, less than 5 angstroms or something like that, then you will see that there is a transfer of information from one proton to the other proton through dipole interaction. The dipole interaction goes as 1 to the third power of the distance inverse, 1 to the third power. So the NOE, the actually information, it goes as the sixth power. So that information is contained in this different kind of a pulse sequence, which is called as the XE or the NOZE. This both represents chemical exchange here or NOE. NOE is the distance coupling, there is a dipolar coupling. Exchange spectroscopy is if there is chemical exchange. If there is chemical exchange also, you will see that kind of a peaks in this spectrum. Here it is a three pulse experiment. You have the pulse 90 degree here, a 90 degree here, and a 90 degree here. This part is the same as the COSY, but here we have introduced a mixing period, which is just a period here, just a time delay. And during this period, there is transfer of information from one spin to another spin because of the dipolar coupling. And then what we will have here is all those magnetization transfers, the self ones as well as the ones which have got the magnetization from another spin. So therefore, you will generate a spectrum of this type. So you see here, you will see correlation from this NH proton to this C alpha, NH proton to this beta, and NH proton to the two methyls here. So you will see this kind of correlations. You will not see this kind of correlations in the COSY spectrum. And therefore, this is the very important structural information here. Schematically in the spectrum, you can see, let us say we start from the particular residue NHI plus one. Okay, let's say I call this as the NH of, this is the residue I plus one, and this side is the I residue. Start from the NHI plus one, and I have also this, of course, the peaks which are present in the COSY, because those are also short distances. From here to here, it is also short distance. From here to this other methyls and all, those are also short distances. Therefore, you will see those peaks here first. From the NHI to the alpha you see here, and the alpha to the beta you see here, and then from the beta to the two methyls you see, these are the COSY type of peaks. But in addition, you also see from the NH to the beta, that is this distance, NH to the beta, and you also see to the NH to the two methyls, those are the these distances. You will see all of these distances here, these are indicated by this filled blue circles. Okay, but it will also see that NH to the alpha of the previous residue, that is, you see from here to here, you will see this distance also in the okay, that is what is indicated. This is the these are the self ones here, these are the self ones alpha, these blue ones, these are the self ones, and then this the cyan ones, these are the sequential ones. Okay, so NHI plus one to the alpha of this residue, and then you will have alpha to the beta of this residue. Here I plus one side chain is not shown, only the I's side chain is shown, and therefore I have here this alpha, these are the sequential peaks. NHI plus one to the alpha of the ith residue. Okay, so this is the NHI plus one to the alpha of residue I, and that is this. And then you also have to the beta of residue I, that is this peak. Okay, that is this correlation here. And then you have to the two methyls of the residue I, those are these are. So these are sequential correlations here. And now what are these here? These ones will be the self peaks. So NHI plus 1 to the alpha of I plus 1 and then to the beta of I plus 1 or whatever these peaks are. You will see those ones here. So these are the self peaks and these filled ones are the sequential peaks. Similarly, for the ith residue, you also see the self peaks. These are the self peaks now. The cyan ones are the self peaks. So for the residue I is concerned. And these empty ones, these are the sequential ones. So therefore, this will go like that. Therefore, while monitoring these correlations here, correlations in the NOSI spectrum, you can walk along the polypeptide chain by observing these connections. So this is the sequential connection here. From this to this is the sequential connection. You go here, and then from here you go to this, you go here, then another one, go there, and things like that. So this is the way you actually use this NOSI spectrum to obtain sequential correlations in the spectrum. Okay, so now you see how many peaks you will get. You will get a larger number of peaks because in the NOSI spectrum, if you have a large protein, something like that, this is the spectrum of a larger protein, you will see a larger number of peaks. So thousands of peaks. And to analyze all of these, again, is going to be quite a tough job. You have to blow up all of these things. I remember how you used to blow this up in several parts and then connect them together, join them, analyze it manually. However, today there are many, many algorithms which can do this job relatively easily. But this spectrum is still very complex. This is a larger number of peaks, thousands of peaks. How to assign them, how to walk through the chain is not so easy. Therefore, it required further developments in terms of what is called as three-dimensional or multidimensional NMR. So you not only use proton-proton correlations, but you also use proton-heteronuclear correlations such as N15. So this was the bottom one is the 2D proton-proton correlation spectrum, and this one is the proton-nitrogen correlation spectrum here. So this shows you at within amino acid residues, each amide proton will produce one peak to its own N15 residue. Here, of course, you will require N15 labeled proteins. And now molecular biology has come into a great help here because they can produce N15 labeled proteins, C13 labeled proteins, and so on and so forth. So therefore, now what you do is in the three-dimensional spectrum is pull this two-dimensional spectrum along the third dimension on the basis of the N15 chemical shifts. So all those peaks which are crowded here will now get separated into three different planes because there are three nitrogen 15s here. There are three nitrogen 15s. That means that this particular amide chemical shift, there are three N15 chemical shifts. That means three amide protons are overlapping here. So, and then you pull this apart according to the N15 chemical shift, then you get these many peaks, but however, still there are many, and this is because of the C13 chemical shift connections, and you pull them apart using the C13 chemical shift, then you call it as a 4D spectrum. You have this, all the peaks separated in different planes. So if you look at each peak here, it has four coordinates, proton, alpha or whatever, and the amide, then the N15 and the C13. All these chemical shifts are correlated or coded in this particular peak. Similarly for the other ones. Now here is an example of a three-dimensional spectrum. So on one axis, you have the nitrogen axis here. This is the carbon axis here. And this side is the vertical is the proton axis. Now you see these peaks are now in the cube or the cuboid or whatever. If you took projections on any of these planes, then you will get a two-dimensional spectrum corresponding to that. If you took a projection on this, you will have a correlation proton and this side is carbon 13. If you took this plane, then it is proton and nitrogen 15. So in that manner, you can generate various kinds of three-dimensional spectra. Now, of course, all this is not easily said, but it requires a lot of pulse sequence developments. A typical three-dimensional spectrum will have three-dimensional technique will have this kind of pulse sequences. This will contain several pulses, not just two or three. It will contain larger number of pulses, and one has to understand how the spin dynamics happens here. We are not going to go into that detail here, but if one wants to develop these pulse sequences, one has to understand the physics behind all of this, and the physical chemistry background can do this. Okay, now the next development. When you do this kind of pulse sequences here, there are many situations where you throw away a certain component of the magnetization which is unwanted. You say, okay, I don't need this component of the magnetization, so I can just discard this and go ahead, keep that one which is required for me, and finally detect it here. So now that information which you throw is any, it's lost. So the question therefore is, can we recover this information? This actually idea came by making use of more than one receivers. So you can use dual receivers. Means if you have used two receivers, you can collect the data which you are normally throwing it away in a separate receiver. So then of course you will have additional information present. This was originally pioneered by Kupse and Freeman in a series of papers here. And of course we incorporated this in our own pulse sequences. The idea is the following here. So you have a magnetization which is getting transferred from particular proton to the nitrogen 15, and from nitrogen 15 it may be transferred to the carbon 13. And as you are going along, you would have thrown away this magnetization components, and because you want to detect only the proton here, whatever does not interfere with the proton, you will pass it on. But here, this carbon magnetization, if you also collect using a carbon 13 receiver, you put a separate receiver here, then you actually collect this data and this data. Therefore, this data will produce you a two-dimensional spectrum, because this is the T1 and the T2 here. T2 prime produces a two-dimensional spectrum correlating nitrogen 15 and you are labeled the T1 here, nitrogen 15 and carbon 13. And if you collect the data here, this is proton. Therefore, you collect proton, carbon 13 and nitrogen 15. You get the three-dimensional spectrum, and here you'll get a two-dimensional spectrum. Both are extremely useful. And this, I will go ahead, I will demonstrate this to you, how we can do this. We have incorporated this in our own experiments. And so therefore, I have now summarized the various kinds of developments which have happened principally, and what are their applications. Now we have to see what are their applications. Okay. So now applications are many. So the challenges are many. Okay, therefore you generate, each challenge generates a new motivation for development, and that is how it has been going on. So if I show, okay. So with regard to the proteins, basically the challenges came from structural biology. And of course, as was pointed out by metabolomics and pure shift, I will show you all of those things in due course. So NMR methods for proteomics, structural biology and protein folding research. So here is a brief introduction to that, the protein world. Protein world, it starts with the ribosome here. In the ribosome, the protein is synthesized. It comes out in a particular manner, which is the unfolded protein. This unfolded protein, the fate of this is unknown. It may get degraded into small fragments, or it may get aggregated into a kind of a mass, or it can go into the following path, go through certain intermediates and fold to a particular state, which is called as the native state. Often we use this as a protein which is functionally relevant. And these proteins may also be, often one tries to work with these proteins by and large. And this may be crystallized, or it may be whatever. You can study this protein various ways. This may also aggregate. Now these intermediates which are present here, and they may actually also aggregate here and aggregate to form this sort of structures which are called as fibrils. And you notice here many of the diseases which you have today are related to these fibrils. And by and large, fibril state is the most stable state for any protein. So, and this state what you are getting is actually kinetically driven state. The native state, so-called native state, is a kinetically driven state. So if there is a compromise on this kinetics here, then you may go into this sort of a situation and you will get the most stable state, which is the fibrillar state. So that's why with aging, you start getting these kind of effects. And you got various diseases, neurodegenerative diseases happen as a result of this. Now, and then of course, another question which is here is the so-called protein folding problem. How does the protein fold to this state in a rapid manner? Now, because if it has to search the entire conformational space, and this is the so-called folding funnel, the top of the funnel is very broad. This represents the conformational diversity in the conformational space, because there are a larger number of degrees of freedom. Each amino acid has two particular torsion angles, phi and psi, which is what was described by Ramachandran. And if I have 100 amino acid residues, there are 2^100 conformational possibilities, combinations possible. Therefore, if it has to search through all of this, going into them one by one and see whether it is a stable state or not, then it will take ages, years and things like that for the protein to find the right one here. However, that does not happen. It happens many times in few milliseconds. The proteins fold to their state in a few milliseconds. How does that happen? This has been a great paradox. This has been a great puzzle for the structural biologist. Therefore, protein folding has become an important area of research, and trying to understand how the proteins from this particular unfolded state that corresponds to this here folds over to this native state. Are there any barriers here? How does it carry cross over the barriers? So these are important questions. The various intermediates, can we characterize these intermediates and understand the process of folding? Okay, misfolding can happen if the intermediates do not follow that one, and then of course then you get misfolded states. Misfolded states can lead to diseases. Okay, therefore, and you need to determine the structures of all. So these are the issues to understand. Now you need to determine structures very rapidly. This is in the context of proteomics and structural genomics, because you have so many proteins in your cell, 100,000 proteins. Okay, now 100,000 proteins, you want to understand them. You cannot be waiting for years to determine the structure of one protein and design a drug for that particular protein. If you want to understand the system, development structural biology, in the context of medicinal chemistry, what is the interaction between a drug and a protein? It's a target. You need to know the structure of this protein, and you have to be able to determine this very rapidly. Therefore, structure determination of proteins in a rapid manner has been an important issue. And then you have large ordered assemblies such as this. How to characterize this? Why do they form like this? What is the structure in here? Can we study this? Okay, folding and unfolding transitions, and what are the integrities in this here process of folding? How are the intermediates? And these are the issues which one has to understand. So, well, a lot of progress has been made with regard to this, and this is the statistics of the structures determined by NMR over several years. There has been a rapid growth in the structures determined. And you can see in 2019, this is relatively about 2 years old here. So these many proteins have been determined. More than 50,000 proteins have been whose structures have been determined by NMR. Of course, the sizes of these ones are approximately 25 to 30 kd. Initially, they were all small ones, 5 kd, 6 kd, 10 kd, and things like that. But slowly, with the methods developing, the sizes have been pushed up. And we are able to handle proteins of the size of 25-30 kds relatively easily. Okay, but now we are still have other challenges to overcome. In the protein structure and dynamics, what is the dynamics in these proteins? Because often we say it is the dynamics which has a functional role. And then you have the speed issue, which I said proteomics, you have to be able to determine the structures rapidly to understand the genome. Because the genome to metabolome, that is the target of understanding, then you will have to be able to understand the proteomics and determine the structures rapidly. Then you have proteins which are unstable. They are formed for a short period, and then how to determine the structures of those. Then you have unfolded and partially folded proteins. So here, you see there is a category of proteins which are called as intrinsically disordered proteins. Intrinsically disordered proteins, they remain like that only. They don't fold. They don't fold to any particular native state. However, when they interact with some other interactors, targets, they actually fold. Therefore, these proteins are able to perform many different functions in a given system. And there are a large number of such proteins. In fact, it is said that 90% of the proteins have either completely intrinsically disordered structures, or there are domains which are intrinsically disordered. So therefore, it becomes, these are called as IDPs and IDPRs. IDPR means intrinsically disordered protein regions. These are present even in folded proteins. IDPs are the ones which are completely disordered by themselves. And nearly 40% of the proteins are intrinsically disordered. This includes proteins like P53, this is the cancer-related protein, or tau protein, and there are many others like that. Okay. So, and then you have large protein assemblies. So these ones also have to be understood, have remained as challenges. What is the challenge with regard to the proteins intrinsically disordered or the disordered proteins from the NMR point of view? Here is a two-dimensional correlated spectrum. You have the amide proton chemical shifts on this axis, N15 chemical shifts on this axis, and you see for the folded protein, all of these peaks are very well resolved. Here, each peak corresponds to one amino acid residue. So you have amide proton to its own N15. Therefore, this spectrum, the so-called HSQC, this is called as the fingerprint of the amino acid sequence of the protein. Now, If the protein, the same protein gets unfolded, you see this actually the dispersion in the NH proton chemical shift disappears quite significantly. And that is a challenge. That poses the great problems in identifying these individual peaks to specific amino acid residues. But that is what is required. But fortunately, the N15 chemical shift dispersion along this axis still remains quite good. And therefore, one can actually make use of this, exploit this to disperse these various peaks originating from different amino acid residues into different planes. And that leads to the so-called three-dimensional spectroscopy here, as I mentioned to you before. You make use of the nitrogen dispersion along two different axes here. Several people have made efforts in this direction. They have made their efforts in a particular way, in their own implementations, in a particular way. But the basic idea was to disperse this according to the chemical shifts of nitrogen 15 along two axes, and one axis remains as amide proton chemical shift. Now, we also incorporated this concept and developed pulse sequences, which had some certain benefits. Okay, I will come to that a little bit later. And dual receiver, and these experiments which we developed were called as HNN and HNCN. I will describe that a little bit later. And these ones are called as HNN and HNCN. And we incorporated the dual receiver concept in this HNN pulse sequence also here. And this is the same figure what we have there. I'm referring to these were the modifications made in our own pulse sequence called HNN. And we collect the C13 data here, and we collect the amide proton data here. Therefore, I get the three-dimensional spectrum, which has amide proton here, N15 here, and N15 here. And in this, I have C13 here and N15 here. So because I collect the C13 data here, I collect the C-alphas, and I in this axis, I have the N15. Therefore, I have the C13, N15 chemical shift correlation. Here, I have the amide. This is the HNN. HNN means H is one axis, N is another axis. Therefore, these are the three correlations which are present here. Okay. All right. Now, how this, this is a little bit more into the pulse sequence there. The pulse sequence is, of course, quite complicated. We will not go into that in greater detail. I'm just giving you the same, which I showed you schematically. I give you the full pulse sequence here with the various pulses which are present here. And the data is collected here as C-alpha, and data is collected here as amide proton chemical shift. And what sort of a spectrum does it produce? It produces a three-dimensional spectrum HNN and a two-dimensional spectrum C-alpha nitrogen 15 correlation. And this is what I have shown here, the two-dimensional spectrum. So this is like the similar to the HSQC, except that one axis I have the carbon 13, other axis I have the N15. But notice here some very distinguishing feature. I have two different colors here. The two different colors are, these peaks belong to those residues which are glycines. Okay, the glycines do not have the C betas. Okay, therefore they stand distinctly. And all the black ones are the ones which have the C betas. And therefore, this, since these are different colors, means they are positive and negative peaks. This red is a negative peak and black is a positive peak. Because of the sign difference, we can easily identify which are the glycines in your molecule. And so therefore, using these, then you also have the so-called sequential correlations here. That is I to the I minus 1 correlation also you find in this. Therefore, you have twice the number of peaks than in the normal correlation, normal C13, N15 correlation spectrum. And then you can also do a sequential walk here from one residue to the next residue, like they connect the things from here to here, here to here, and here to here, and so on and so forth. So you have a sequential walk possible along the polypeptide chain in this two-dimensional spectrum using the C13, N15 correlation spectrum. The advantage here is N15 correlation dispersion is very good, and the C-alpha correlation dispersion is also very good, because you notice C-alpha dispersion goes from about 40 ppm to 60 ppm C-alpha in the carbon chemical shift. Unlike the amide proton chemical shift, there is only 0.3 ppm. Here you are able to go up to 20 ppm difference. And therefore, all the peaks will get better resolved, and you can actually walk along the polypeptide chain relatively easily. And that is what is demonstrated here. Okay, now we can do something more than that. See, in the earlier case, what we did was we collected the data somewhere in between, right? In the carbon 13, we collected the data carbon 13 here, and the proton was collected here. Now, well, we can do something else, that you collect the data at the same time on the two channels here. So this is a T3 and T3 prime. Simultaneously you collect it. You keep both the channels open here. Carbon data is collected here and amide proton chemical data is collected here. So you do a certain trick here, what is called as polarization sharing. So you start from the H alpha magnetization and label this as T1, transfer to the C alpha, and then the C alpha magnetization is transferred to the nitrogen of the I and the I plus 1 residues, and some of it is remains as C alpha on the C alpha, and then you label this during this in this pathway. So that is you, this is the first mixing here, and this pathway you label the nitrogen of I and I plus 1, and in this pathway you label the C alpha I, and finally transfer this to the carbonyl here, and in this case you transfer to the amide proton. So eventually you detect the amide proton chemical shifts here, and here you detect the carbonyl chemical shifts. Therefore, what is the information content from this? Information content is indicated here. So you start from the H alpha, as I showed you here, start from H alpha, go to the C alpha, and part of it remains in C alpha. Then you transfer to the nitrogen 15 here and the nitrogen 15 here, and you continue with this through the HN to the amide proton, and continue from here to here through the amide proton, and what is present here, you take it to the carbonyl here and you detect the carbonyl. Therefore, you get here carbonyl chemical shift detection, and you generate a two-dimensional data set. So you get actually two three-dimensional data sets. Okay, so you have the labelings here, two three-dimensional data. So you have here T1, T2, T3. And you have T1, T2 prime, T3 prime. So you get two 3D spectra in the same experiment. So therefore, what is the information in these two 3D spectra? So we call this as HACACO, and this one is called as HACANH. This spectrum displays correlations from the amide proton to the N15 of I plus 1 and I minus 1 and I. This represents one correlation here to the carbonyl of this carbonyl, which is present here. Okay, in this three-dimensional spectrum. Therefore, to summarize all of that, what indicated here, this one experiment, you have the alpha of I, nitrogen of I and I plus 1, amide of I and I plus 1, nitrogen of I and I plus 1, C alpha of I, and carbonyl of I. These many chemical shifts you get in one experiment. So that is actually enough to actually calculate the spectrum. Well, subsequently, we developed a large number of other modifications of these pulse sequences, and I've just listed here those various developments. We need not go into that. Whenever there is a requirement, one can actually go to the original papers here, implement them in your spectrometer. Many of these are actually there on the Bruker spectrometers. So you can use this and record the spectra of your protein molecules. Okay. So now, with this, we actually studied a large number of proteins. I've just listed here a small number. In fact, this is a slide which has been made about 8-10 years ago. And subsequently, many more proteins have been investigated by various groups. I'm not listing all of those ones here. Okay, now we go to the next challenge, that we want to do things faster. Now, those experiments took us a couple of days. If you took at each one of those, a 3D experiment, we took about some 48 hours and things like that. Or some of them were taking in 2 days, somewhere in 1.5 days and things like that. So now we used to use another concept, which is called as non-uniform sampling. Typically, this is a strategy where you actually don't collect this full the data as it is indicated here, the uniform sampling here, the T2 and the T2 and T1 time domain data. You don't sample all the data points, but you sample only some of those. That means you collect FIDs only for these data combinations, the T1, T2 combinations. And subsequently, you do statistical manipulations to fill in all of these things here. And there are algorithms for doing that. And that is called as non-uniform sampling. And then another modification, which is due to the so-called delay optimization here. And as a result of this, what happens? Now, the normal experiment, the best combination of HNN took us 15 hours. But this NUS best HNN took us 1 hour 30 minutes. Now you notice here, in 1 hour 30 minutes, we are collecting a three-dimensional data set without loss of information. because we have indicated here the sequential connectivities in the individual between the individual residues, sequential walk, and the same sequential walk is possible here in this spectrum as well. Okay, so this 1 hour 30 minutes is quite a substantial reduction in the time required for acquiring the data. Okay, well, you can implement this in other experimental sequences as well, and this is one particular experiment which is called HNCO CACB. Okay, and this is called as HNCO. Okay, we will not go into this details of this, only to indicate that these experiments, these are three-dimensional experiments. This we could collect in 28 minutes, and this we could collect in 22 minutes. Okay, and this experiment was in 1 hour 29 minutes, 28 minutes, and 22 minutes. All these are 3D experiments. Therefore, you put together, you collect all the data in 2 hours. Now, this much data is sufficient to calculate the structure of the protein. And this is what is shown here. On the basis of the 5 chemical shifts which you'll get along the polypeptide backbone, you get the backbone fold of the protein. And this is the Rosetta, is an algorithm which is developed by Edmax in NIH. And you can use the chemical shifts to calculate the structure of the molecule. And you superimpose this over the crystal structure, and you can see this RMSD is only 0.93. So the structure is calculated very well on the basis of the chemical shifts. And now you are getting this data in 2 hours. There are algorithms to automate this, and we will also show you some of those developments. Okay, now automation. If these peaks are there, which are able to give you the assignments rapidly, it would be very helpful if you can automate this assignment process, so that if you, on the one of our deems was that you supply the, put the sample on the spectrometer, push a button to collect the data, and push another button to obtain the assignments. So that sort of a strategy, that sort of an idea. So this we developed a software for what is called Autoba. On the basis of our own experiments, this was done by a project student called Aditi Borkar. She was there with me for about a year, and during that time she wrote this software, and this, the test of that is indicated here. And we experimentally we collected some data, but we should test it for more spectra. Therefore, what we did was we looked at the BMRB data database, where the chemical shifts of large number of proteins are deposited. Now you take these chemical shifts and synthesize a spectrum and give the spectrum to the program without telling the assignments, of course. You ask it to assign the spectra and calculate and see whether you got the correct result or not. And you see, we developed it for nearly 40 proteins. Only 20 are listed here, but nearly 40 proteins, we did it. And then, of course, in every case, you get things like 97-98% precision accuracy with regard to the assignment. So that was extremely helpful. And then following that, we actually wrote a typical guideline as to how to calculate the structure rapidly. So in about it, backbone fold in 2 days, structure, you can get it in 2 days. You collect all these two-dimensional and three-dimensional spectra. You can also do projection data. You do the projections, all two-dimensional, which you can collect in rapidly in about 2 hours and things like that. And you collect, automate the assignments here. And you collect the minimum of NOEs which are required to connect the backbones, and with those you calculate the structure of the molecule using algorithms called Cyana. Cyana was developed by Kutwitrick's lab in the 1980s. This is a very fairly old program. It was Peter Guntert, who was a postdoc with a graduate student with Kutwitrick. So then you get the structure calculated like that, structure in 2 days. Okay, this is a demonstration of that one here, the backbone fold from the minimal data set, and you also see the comparison here with regard to the known structure. And the RMSDs are extremely small, except at the ends here where they are high because the things are very flexible in that regions, and therefore those regions are not very well defined. In all other areas where there is no flexibility, the structures are determined fairly well. Okay. So that is the structure determination with regard to the speed and with regard to the size, or how much data collection has to be done. Now we turn to another issue, which is typically relevant for medicinal chemistry. And this is, you use complex mixture, herbal products. Herbal products you can use to study their interaction with the protein systems. Okay, now herbal products contain many, many compounds. Okay, now which of these, and you notice that herbal products are very effective against many diseases. The same product is has efficacy against different diseases. For example, Trifala is one of those which actually we demonstrated ourselves that it actually hinders the fibrillation process of alpha-synuclein. It also kills cancer cells. It also does not allow the proliferation of the cancer cells. These are completely different processes. And there are multiple pathways inside them. And different components of these herbal mixtures will be acting on those ones. And that's why you have relatively less side effects when you use herbal products. Now we try to understand this in a top-down approach. So how do we do the NMR for that purpose? So here you have a complex mixture, which is a herbal product. And then you have a complex system, as this may be a protein or this may be a cell. Then you study an interaction between these two. And then you do an NMR filtering, that is only those which are interacting with this system will show up in your result. All others will get suppressed. Okay. And there's a kind of a filtering process. And what changes does it cause to the system itself? You also monitor it here in the system. Okay. So this requires NMR pulse sequence development again. And we developed a particular experiment, which is called as ProSmash. So this is protein HSQC and C13 HSQC. The protein HSQC is of the HSQC of the given protein and C13 HSQC of the small molecular signals. Okay, you collect them in one experiment. In one experiment, you design a pulse sequence, whereas one particular portion of the experiment, you collect the protein signals, and in the other portion of the experiment, you collect the small molecular signals in the C13 manner. Here it is N15 and here it is C13. And this of course requires a N15 labeled protein, and carbon-13 here is at natural abundance. Because in the drug molecules, which are herbal products, you can't label them. So they are at natural abundance. So therefore you study this interaction and it's demonstrated here. How does it work? So this is the protein and this is the sample tube which contains your protein as well as the small molecule. And we made an artificial mixture of these to demonstrate the process. Here, these are the several compounds which are mixed, and they were all put here in the sample tube. Now, with that pulse sequence, you collect the N15 HSQC, which shows the signals of the protein alone. And you collect the C13 HSQC, which shows the signals of these small molecules alone. And therefore, you can easily figure out then, depending upon the interactions, you can figure out what changes have happened here. And you also collect a normal control. Okay. When you do the control, then you can actually see what changes have happened here as a result of the interaction with this. And that is how the filtering process happens. Okay. Then I show you here the actual experimental data with regard to herbal product. This is the Trifala. Trifala here, this is the interaction with the alpha-synuclein. Alpha-synuclein, you see here, there is a superposition of HSQC spectra of alpha-synuclein presence and absence of Trifala. The red peaks are the ones which are in the absence of Trifala, and the blue peaks are the ones which are in the presence of Trifala. The protein concentration is here 150 micromolar. Okay, so now, and then this is 0.5 mg milligram per ml, and this is 0.5 mg milligram per ml of Trifala. Okay, now you see here, there are many peaks which are absent in the alpha-synuclein spectrum in the absence of Trifala. The moment you add Trifala, those ones have come up. What is the implication of this? The implication is that whatever process was happening in free alpha-synuclein is getting hindered or it is getting suppressed. Possibly it is an oligomerization process. In the oligomerization process, two of protein molecules come close to each other. They are in exchange because of the association process. Associate, dissociate, that exchange process which may be happening. And there are certain regions of the protein which are involved in that. And those regions which are involved in that exchange process get broadened out and you don't see the signals coming from those. The moment you put Trifala there, it interferes with this exchange process and stabilizes the protein in a particular way. Therefore, the oligomerization is stopped and therefore it prevents the fibrillation process. We have demonstrated that Trifala inhibits the fibrillation of alpha-synuclein, and that is indicated here. The ones which are absent, they are indicated in the green and they show up once you put the Trifala, okay? And now notice here, all these are threonine residues or serine residue. The serine and threonine residues are in the side chain, they have the OH group. So therefore, there is a kind of an interaction through the OH groups. And now what does Trifala contain? Trifala contains mostly polyphenols and polyols. Okay, large number of these are polyphenols and they also contain OH groups. Therefore, they go and interfere with this association process, and the proteins are therefore in or in the monomeric form. And that results in a better signal-to-noise ratio for all the peaks and therefore the drop. Therefore, now you see we have understood the mechanism of interaction or mechanism of association of the alpha-synuclein protein. And we also have seen how these drug products are able to interfere with that. Okay, now we can go further and indicate a mechanism for this self-association process. This is the summary of that one here. And this is the gel picture to show the monomerization of this alpha-synuclein oligomer in the presence of triphala. So here is the schematic of, in the absence of triphala, you have this oligomer formation here. When you add triphala, this equilibrium is shifted to this monomer here and you get very sharp signals. Okay, then you want to improve the further resolution in the spectrum, and that is done by what is called as pure shift NMR. Pure shift NMR of triphala mixture, because as you know, triphala contains hundreds of compounds. Now you have to be able to figure out which of these compounds are actually contributing to that. So you need to improve the quality of your NMR spectra, and using the pure shift NMR, you can improve the signal, improve the resolution in the spectrum. Okay, these are the conventional HSQC, and this is the pure shift HSQC with a certain kind of a processing here, and you see the improvement in the resolution. You make this comparison here. This is the toxic spectrum in the normal case, and this is with the pure shift toxic spectrum, GIC pure shift. This is the processing technique, GIC, general indirect covariance processing. So this results in a very high resolution spectrum. You may lose the signal to noise a little bit, but then so long as you are able to observe the signals, that is fine. Okay, so that is so far as the interaction between drug molecules or protein structures. Now we shift to this folding problem. Folding transitions. I indicated to you the folding, how this happens. So you come back to this picture here. So we want to understand how the protein goes from here to here. So, but you have to simulate this process. What to do? You take a protein which has a well-defined structure, and you denature the protein to reach here. So therefore, and then you systematically go down to this state and monitor the changes that happen in your NMR spectrum. That is this indication here. So this is the spectrum of the unfolded protein, which is on the top of the funnel here. And you keep changing the conditions of this unfolding so that the protein slowly starts to fold. As it starts to fold, you see that the peaks start disappearing. Various peaks start getting broadened out here, and then slowly the peak disappear. And when you come to this state, of course, you will have a well-folded protein and you see all the peaks present here. So this you can monitor systematically. And this is indicated in this. And to put the whole thing in a perspective, I just show you here what the changes that are having place. This is the denatured protein, and you slowly change the conditions of the denaturation. The protein starts to acquire certain structure. In between, of course, the motions are getting slow. These colors indicate different motional conditions. As the motions become slow, the lines will get broadened and the structure gets formed. Therefore, you start forming helices here and then the sheet structures here. At this point, you have the at 3 molar, 5 molar, you have these 3 helices formed. And as you go further down in the concentration of urea, you come to 4 molar. See, this particular helix is gone. This sheet is also gone. And you have only 2 helices and this one here. When you come to 3 molar, all of these actually disappear. All these secondary structures which are formed here, they disappear. The protein is completely unfolded. Now, why does it happen? Because these helices which are getting formed here, these are not native helices. These are non-native helices. These are not wanted. In the final folded spectrum, where it has to go, these helices should not exist. Helices exist at some other places. So therefore, it has to undo what it has done here. And therefore, it is completely opened up. And then it goes into this state at 1 molar. It is a folded state. Helices are here. And the beta sheets are here. And you can see here, this is the line widths indicating here. The red ones are the ones which are showing exchange process. The exchange process are between those residues which are in close proximity in the final folded structure. This indicates the protein is trying to fold to this state. Therefore, these ones are coming in and going. And that is why the lines are broadened and you will not see all these structures are gone. And when it comes here, you have the proper structure formed. And in the end, this you have the proper sheets formed. So this is how we demonstrated the folding process, equilibrium transitions down the funnel. And we also demonstrated here that the folding process does not necessarily go through the native contacts alone, because this is the kinetic process. Initially, it may form certain kind of contacts which are stable at that point because of the pathway selection. And then when it starts to remove those ones, actually it may reach the final destination. Sometimes if it doesn't reach the final destination, then we generate what are called as misfolded proteins. And these misfolded proteins are responsible for various diseases. Here also we demonstrated this in the case of another protein, which is HIV protease, which is a dimer. And identified the cores which are initially formed. And slowly you start seeing here the core formation where the structure is getting formed. These colors indicate the structures getting formed in those areas. And you also see the cooperativity, which ones are formed first, which one for second. The green and the blue color indicate the stepwise formation of the structure. Therefore, this indicates a kind of a cooperativity. When you are forming one structure, it induces the neighboring fellow to fold, and therefore the cooperativity of the transitions, folding transitions, is demonstrated in this process. Of course, these are relatively old data. Many of you may have already seen this, but for a perspective, I have tried to cover all of these things. Now, large protein assemblies, this deals with, a lot of people have thought about these ones, how to get over these ones. Study this, because the large protein's difficulty is the lines are extremely broad. And therefore, their detection is very difficult. Here it is an indication of the line weights. These are the amide proton line weights, and this is the spectrometer frequencies. Okay, there is a correlation between the spectrometer frequency and the line weight. Okay, and this is the correlation time, means this indicates how fast the molecule is tumbling in solution. This is called correlation time. Okay, three different, if the correlation time is large, it means that the molecule is very sluggish in its motion. So it is tumbling very slow. This is a very large molecule. This curve is for a very large molecule. Okay, and these ones for relatively smaller molecules. Okay, 60 megabits. Notice here the variation in the line weights and correlation with the spectrometer frequency is quite sharp for large molecules. It goes here at 500 megahertz, it has a line width of 50 hertz, and when it goes to 1000 megahertz, it comes to like 10 hertz. Therefore, there is a large change in the line width, and that is the motivation for going to higher and higher magnetic fields if you want to go to large molecules. The higher magnetic fields, of course, increases the dispersion. That is one aspect, increases the sensitivity, but it also changes the line widths. And therefore, this is an important factor to take into consideration. For small molecules, the benefits may not be too large. Whether you go from 500 to 1000 megahertz, you see, it is a very small change in the line width. So you may not benefit much from the point of view of line width changes. But for large molecules, this makes an important contribution as to how it should be. This is for the amide proton, and this is for the nitrogen 15. The same correlation for the nitrogen 15. And once again, you see the correlation is very large for large molecules. This is a correlation of 320 nanoseconds. So that is extremely large. This will like some megadalton size protein, if you have, it will have this sort of a correlation. And this actually is a picture taken from one of these papers of Utrecht. And I will show you his results, how they achieved, what did they do to get good spectra in such large systems. So here is an experiment called as PROSI, which is developed in 1997 by Utrecht's group. And this is called as PROSI. This is the relaxation optimized spectroscopy. Relaxation optimized meaning because this monitors the T2 relaxation. The T2 relaxation is responsible for the line width, which I showed you the line width. So you optimize the line width, and therefore then you can get a good spectrum. Okay, the idea is the following, that in the particular N15 proton correlation peak, if you see, there are four components for every peak. And this is because of the proton N15 coupling. The proton N15 coupling is about 90 hertz. Okay. So therefore, along the proton axis also the splitting will be there. Along the nitrogen axis also there will be splitting. So therefore, each cross peak for the center is here. Center of this chemical shift center is here. Okay, here and here. Okay, and then this this is the splitting in proton. This is about 90 hertz. This is also 90 hertz. Now there are four components. However, all these four components do not have the same relaxation behaviors. Do not have the same line weights. Okay, and that is indicated here. You see these four components here. This is extremely broad, therefore it is very low in intensity. And these are also different. This is the sharpest one. This line is extremely sharp. Okay. Now, if you when you take an average all of this, if you decouple this, if you remove this coupling, and if you remove this coupling, you get a peak which is in the middle here. And this is, of course, quite broad. This is one single peak in the normal HSQC, one single peak, which is quite broad. So what you do is the idea here was, okay, let us not do a decoupling here. And we retain the coupling, but we pick up only this component. That's why it is called as relaxation optimized spectroscopy, transverse relaxation optimized spectroscopy. You pick up only this particular component. Okay, now you see this is a sharp signal. Although it's chemical shift, the peak is slightly shifted, but that doesn't matter. This we can always correct it. We know the coupling constant because the coupling constant doesn't change. One bond coupling constant doesn't change very much. Therefore, we can always correct for that. But this line is very sharp. As a result of this, you see this result here. And this is the normal correlation spectrum, HSQC spectrum. We also call it as COSY. This is the kind of a spectrum which you get when you do the normal, where you have the decoupling involved. And this is the TROSY spectrum. See, the same spectrum is now resolved so much. All the peaks are so very well resolved. So, and these are the cross sections through these various signals. This is the COSY cross section. And this is the TROSY cross section. Of course, there is a small shift here in the position. That's because of the coupling which I mentioned to you. But notice this, yes, the intensities are so low here. Look at this intensity. Okay. So this is a significant improvement. And you can see that even more prominently in this particular spectrum. This is the HSQC spectrum. And this is the TROSY spectrum. So much of overlap in the peaks here. And this is so well resolved in this. Okay. This is a dramatic development for the large molecular applications. This will not be useful for small molecules, by the way. Remember that. Excuse me. Hello? Lecture code likhtini amel maatadtini. Okay. So you see that this is what an improvement here, phenomenal improvement. And no wonder therefore this became an actually important, it was soon after this actually Vitruv got the Nobel Prize. And there are further improvements here, crypt and crenept. I only show you the results here. So this is the GRO-L-GRO-S complex. This is the total 900 kilodalton system. Okay. And this is a assembly of many different proteins here. The lower portion is called as GRO-L and the top portion is called as GRO-S. And this is actually a chaperon, and all the proteins that go into this is actually helps proteins to fold properly. Okay. And this experiment, the TROSY experiment of this small peptide, which is on the top here, this is the 10 kilodalton protein, but it is sitting on the top. Of course, when it is sitting on the top of all of this, the whole thing becomes as one assembly and the lines will be extremely broad. You cannot see those. Typically, but however, in the TROSY spectrum, you could see this of the free one, and in the crypt TROSY, it became even better. You have better resolution here, and then when it is bound to SR1, you could see nothing. This whole thing becomes very large. This is 400 kilodalton, and this is another 520 kilodalton. So total, when it is taken, nothing was seen here. But now, in this experiment, in the crypt TROSY, you could see those peaks of those 10 amino acid of the 7 kilodalton system, which is present here. Those peaks could be seen. So therefore, you can go to larger and larger systems using these techniques. And small molecules, of course, one should not try this because there is no benefit. In fact, there will be a loss of signal-to-noise ratio because you are throwing away three components and picking up only one component. Okay, now this is a statistic of applications here. The magnets in the 1980s were 500 megahertz. Then 1990s, you got 600 megahertz. And then you have around 1998, you got 800 megahertz, 900 megahertz. Then of course, now we also have, now this is 2005 1 gigahertz. Now last year I have seen 1.2 gigahertz NMR spectrometers. And these of course are very expensive. We cannot afford it. And only some few places in the world have these spectrometers. And the cryo probes is another issue, which actually they actually help improve the signal to noise ratios of the spectra. Okay, now I will deal with this self-association. That was from the development point of view. I will use a different approach here, how to study this association process, getting inside details about the association process itself. Okay, this is, I'll take this using an example here of a particular protein called as dynamin, which is involved in a process called as endocytosis. Okay, so this protein is, what is the endocytosis process? If there is a small molecule, if it has to be internalized, when it comes close to the membrane engulfs it, and then when this engulfs it, there is a protein which is here, dynamin, which forms a fiber type of a structure and wraps along the neck of this vesicle, and with GTP hydrolysis, and this is turned off. Therefore, this is internalized here, okay? And this protein is responsible for this process of binding at the neck and isolating it from the rest of the system, okay? And this is a budding clathrin-coated vesicle, okay? Now, our interest was here. This is the protein which is from the fiber as a result of self-association, okay? How does that happen? Let's look at this. The dynamin itself is 864 amino acid residues. It contains these many domains. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 domains. And out of these, this is called the GTPase effector domain, which is responsible for the self-association of the protein into a long filament. Okay, and that is the one which you are targeted to understand. Okay, so now you take this NMR of large assembly. This is the way the assembly has happened. If this is the case, you don't get any NMR signals at all. And here I have, if you look at such an assembly and look at the CD spectrum of that, it tells you that, okay, it has a structure. It has a helical structure, okay? So, and then you look at the TEM image. This is the transmission electron microscopy. You see that there are particles which you can see in the image. So these are very big systems. They are very big systems. And if you look at the HSQC spectrum, proton N15 correlation spectrum, you only see 28 peaks, whereas you should see actually 138 peaks for the corresponding monomer. If it were a monomer, I should see 138 peaks, but I'm only seeing 28 peaks. Of course, all these 28 peaks must belong to a flexible region of the protein, and they must be contiguous. And one could actually assign these individual peaks to particular amino acid residues, following the processes which I described earlier. And these ones belong to the C-terminal of the protein. Yeah, N-terminal of the protein. Okay, now how do we understand the process of self-association? Okay, now this is the spectrum which is the result of 28 peaks which I showed you. The strategy we adopted for this was, okay, let us dissociate this into monomers. If we dissociate into monomers, we're using some dissociation tricks like the denaturants and things like that. You dissociate into monomers. Now this monomer will give you all the peaks, and that is this one here. However, it also loses the structure, because when you're using denaturants, you lose the structure also. And you, although you get all the peaks, you can assign them. Now what you do is first to denature it, assign all the peaks, and start monitoring as you go from here to here to here. And that is indicated by this here. Stepwise, you move from this state to this state. And you monitor the peaks which are disappearing, that will tell you systematically how the protein is associating to form a big assembly like that. Okay, that is shown here. So you start with this denatured protein and slowly start changing the conditions. Here we use the DMSO as a denaturant. Okay, so here it is in 100% DMSO. All the peaks are visible, and this is 90%, 85%, 80%, and finally when it is 50%, everything is associated. You only see these few peaks here. Okay, so now you are systematically monitoring the peaks which are disappearing, which means that those are the ones which are going into the core of the assembly. Okay, that is indicated by the color coding here. So stepwise, you see the changes that are happening based in a contiguous manner. certain segments go into the interior and certain segments go later. Okay, so that is indicated by this slide here. Initially, it is all here, and then slowly as they are going in, you see the association is happening. This is the color coded, and that is monitored by the spectral changes here. Initially, you have all the peaks which are present here. You monitor the intensities of all of these. These are by the relaxation data. Monitor all the relaxation data you can monitor, and slowly lines start broadening. When they broad, because of the fold, because they fold, they disappear. And when they further fold, they disappear. More residues disappear, and finally you get only few peaks which are present in this one. So this is how you monitor the changes that are happening in the protein as a result of the self-association process. Systematically, you can fold this, and then of course you have this picture generated as a result of this model association process. So you initially you have an unfolded protein. Initially, it forms certain kind of oligomers. Then the structure is getting formed. When the structure is getting formed, they tend to associate, and then it forms the process. And this association happens as the result of these electrostatic interactions here, because this helices are formed. These have positive and negative charge distributions, and then because of these Coulomb interactions, they start associating. Okay, and these are in the opposite directions. This is one molecule from here to here. This is another molecule from here to here. This is N to C. This is N to C. So there is complementary charges here, and because of this, they associate. Okay, and therefore this forms an assembly like this. Now, as you go further, then the more helices are getting formed, and this some helices remain and some portion remains completely unfolded. That is the N terminal here, and that is the C terminal here. Okay, so you have N terminal and C terminal because they are going in the opposite directions. You have the loop here and also the loop here, which are flexible. Okay, so on both sides you have this kind of arms which are unfolded. Now we assemble this in the form of a cylinder. Okay, so you have the loop here and the flexible region here, the flexible region here. These are the N terminals. Okay, N terminal of one residue on chain, N terminal of another chain, N terminal of this chain, N terminal of this chain, and so on. So then these ones start assembling in this manner. Then you form a tall rope. This is the rope which you are talking about with regard to GED self-association. So when this happens, you can see you attach all your other components, GED and other domains, to this molecule, and you can generate this kind of a model for the self-association of dynamine in this manner. Okay, well, you can stretch your imagination further, and then you see these, the two arms which are there, these N-terminal fragments, they actually are positively charged, and they can actually bind to the lipid surfaces. The lipid surfaces are negatively charged, so they can hold this onto the lipids around the membrane surface, and then they wrap around this membrane surface in the neck of the vesicle. Okay, so they wrap around like this, and they form a kind of a rope which holding the neck, and that is how the picture we generated for this dynamine assembly with the GED. Okay, so the one next topic, structure function relationship. How do we understand structure function relationships here? So here is an example of a protein called what is dynein light chain protein. This is the transport protein. Okay, it transports some kind of a cargo from one portion of the cell to another portion of the cell. This moves on a filament called as microtubule. So this is that thing. And from here, there is a small protein here which actually carries this cargo. This is the cargo. Okay, this is the dynein, and this is the light chain which is present here, which is the cargo. And that blow up of that is indicated here. Okay, and these are called the heavy chains. These are attached to the microtubule, and these are the ones which are binding the cargo. Okay, so this moves, the heavy chains are bind to the cargo on the microtubule, they move like this. And they carry the cargo which is bound to this DLC8 protein. Okay, and this is a dimer here. Now the dimer, and this dissociates into monomer at pH 3, and it is a dimer at pH 7. So how does this work? So look at this here now. So this is a dimer, and at the interface, there is a place which is the cargo. The cargo can bind at the interface, at the interface of the two. One monomer is here, another monomer is here, and the cargo is binding here at the dimer interface. Okay, Now, if it has to transport, what it has to do is it should bind to the cargo at one place and release it at another place. How does this happen? This is the question one has to ask. And here we see that dynamics in the protein plays a very important role. Protein has different dynamics, and this will be dependent on the conditions inside the cell. So one signal, if it comes to change the conditions, then it can change the dynamics, and then it can cause this binding and dissociations happen. Though this is what happens here. In this particular case, what I have shown in the red color is the areas which are actually quite dynamic in nature. And now you see, using a cargo, we actually use the peptide to act as a cargo. So at pH 7, so we have this spectrum here of the dimer. Okay, this is just the dimer. Okay, now you see a certain peaks which are isolated, which can monitor that. These are relatively distinct, and we can monitor every one of those also, but I've indicated a few of those. Now, when you put the peptide, what happens here? You see, there is the duplicate. This peak moves to this place, and there is also a duplication. And this peak moves here. Okay, this peak moves here, and this peak moves here. And likewise, this peak moves to here, but it is disappearing there. Okay, so therefore, because of this binding, there are some changes happening here. The one which was here has moved here. The one which was here has moved here. Likewise, the one which was here has moved here. The one which was here has moved here. So these spectral, the peak movements are indicating that there is a peptide binding, and this is the result of that. Now you notice you change this pH. This is at pH 7. This is also at pH 7. This peak, as I said, has moved to this point at pH 7 on binding to the peptide. Now we change the pH. Make it to 6. Now you see in this pH 6, some intensity comes back here. Okay? Some intensity comes back here. What does that mean? This means that the efficacy of binding has been compromised. So in other words, some peptide is released. Therefore, pH therefore can act as a switch for cargo trafficking. A small change in the pH can actually cause this binding and release of the cargo. This is what we demonstrate. We call it as a pH switch for cargo trafficking. Okay. Now, one final application here I want to show you, that if you are working with very large proteins, often you may be interested in the so-called active site of the protein. So-called active site of the protein is the place where the functions happen. And what do the active sites generally contain? Okay, now here I have shown you the residues which are present in the active site by and large. And it is by and large, it is three, four residues, D, E, N, and Q. Aspartate, glutamate, asparagine, and glutamine. These four residues are present. And we are very fortunate that all these four residues have carbonyl in the side chain. How is that useful? Okay, now here is a spectrum which I'm showing you, a five-dimensional spectrum which we record, or five-dimensional in the sense that two parallel 3D experiments which were done, and they show these various kinds of peaks. But interestingly, you have a certain set of peaks here which are originating from the carbonyls. Carbonyls of these four residues, they only appear here. Therefore, these appear distinctly in the spectrum. We can monitor these to see what changes are happening in this active site of the protein as a result of certain interaction, any drug which is coming in, things like that. So this is an important application for large molecules. Even though you may not be interested in studying the entire protein, a small section of the protein can also be studied, particularly the active site, and monitor the changes that happen in the active site as a result of the interaction. Okay, so I think I have come to the close here. I have talked for almost 1.5 hours now. So so a lot of people have worked on this. This is I covered a research over several years, maybe decades to some extent. A large number of students are involved, and some postdocs at various places, several NMR machines, and the methods developments are these are different projects which are there. Okay, so all of these I have shown you. I have talked to you on all of these subjects. And the students who are at the CBS now, at the Center for Excellence in Basic Sciences, I've shown those pictures here of those. This is Veer Mohan, who is involved in the development of pulse sequences, especially with regard to pure shift NMR. and other non-informed sampling and nadamad and things like that. And Kavita, she is his wife. She is also, she's an organic chemist. She is very helpful in, and also an expert in NMR. Anushree, she is a biochemist, and she is extremely, and she is now working on protein structures and interaction in the nucleosome. And Sinjan, she is a physical chemist, and she is involved in the alpha-synuclein work. So much of got initiated from her. And this is Sunita. I have not talked about the molecular dynamics work, but we actually have used molecular dynamics and molecular docking in various places. And Vaibhav, this is a postdoc. He was a postdoc. He came from Lucknow. He also worked on several proteins. With all of those summary of the results I have mentioned, this is generally various proteins are involved. So these are the people who actually are at CBS. All of them are not there now. Vaibhav Shukla has gone, has taken as a postdoc and gone to UK. He is doing extraordinarily well over there. And then you have here a PhD student. He is my last PhD student, Mandar, who is now finishing his PhD at TIFR. All the other students, they are there. Of course, I've mentioned their names there, but he is currently there. Therefore, I have his picture here. And this is a student who has also interacted on pulse sequence developments on various Geneca, this one. So finally, the various NMR facilities, various NMR instruments, NMR center, we are not only the NMR facility at TIFR Hyderabad, we also use the NMR center at ICT Hyderabad, NMR center at IIT Bombay, and then the Department of Chemistry for IIT Bombay. We have used here the various other other tools like TEM we have used, and the isothermal titration calorimetry we use, and the TM facility of IIT Bombay, all of these ones have been used. So I think I covered a large portion, and any, okay, this is the TFR picture, 800 megahertz NMR spectrometer here, and this is the 600 megahertz spectrometer. So with that, I thank you. Thank you for your attention. Any questions, I'll be very pleased to answer.
Thank you very much, sir. That was indeed very insightful. As always, we have enjoyed listening to your class. With permission, I have a couple of questions from the participants. May I read them out to you?
Sure, sure.
Dr. Kanyalkar wants to know...
Just let me pause you.
Yes.
If possible, sir, please stop sharing your screen and...
Should I share the screen? I stopped sharing the screen. One minute. Yes. Now, what do I do for that? How do I go?
Sometimes this can help. So you have to go back to your Teams.
I have to go back to the Teams. Kidhar gaya wo?
Sir, you're at the bottom. Where up to Chrome.
One minute. Yeah. Let me see at the Chrome. Okay. So here I have to stop sharing the screen.
Yes, you can see that Teams Microsoft.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I've stopped now?
Yes, sir. You have stopped sharing. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Yeah. May I read the questions now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But so you can see me, you cannot see me.
No, sir, we can't see you.
Okay, this video is off. Okay. Is it on? Video on?
Sir, not yet. Yeah, now it is on. Yes, sir.
Okay. But I can't see you. I can't see anybody.
Oh, okay. You want to see me?
Yeah. No, see, if you have face-to-face contact, the understanding is better.
Yes, sir. Can you see me now?
I can see you now. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. So, yeah. Dr. Kanyalkar wants to know if we are studying a drug peptide binding using NMR studies, and if the peptide size is about 20 to 24 amino acids, what kind of experiments do you recommend, and what kind of solvent systems do you recommend for that?
See, if it is a drug, I would think that you would want to work in water. Is it soluble or not?
Let's assume it is soluble.
If it is soluble, I mean, if it is a drug, I would think that it should be soluble, because then only, I mean, it becomes a good drug. That is, bioavailability may be better, but sometimes may not be soluble to a very large extent. Okay. If it is soluble, then the first thing to do is to do a toxi spectrum. Toxi and nausea spectra.
Okay.
Two-dimensional toxi and nausea spectra, and study their interaction.
Right.
Chemical shift perturbations that happen, of the individual peaks. That is a so COSY spectrum, double quantum filtered COSY or COSY. You measure the for the NOE, you can see the changes that are happening in that one. Or by the relaxation measurements, you can study what are the exchanges that are happening. So if the drug is binding to the peptide, so some portion of which portion of the peptide is involved in the binding. So you can monitor this by chemical shift changes or also by the relaxation changes. The relaxation changes mean the R2s, if you measure R2s, transverse relaxation rates. So there you will see a chemical exchange effects. Line broadening will happen selectively in certain regions. And that is the one which I showed you also in the process of a self-association, where the binding is happening, there is a line broadening. So the same thing will happen here as well.
Right, sir.
Does that answer your question?
I believe so. Okay. So the next question is by our coordinator, Dr. Premlata. She wants to know if while studying synthesized biopolymers, drug conjugates, who have molecular weights around 100 kilodaltons or so, what kind of resolution do the NMR machine should have to get good enough resolution of the
Now, so 100 kilodalton is of course a large protein. It's a large system. Now, what is the information you are trying to derive from there? Okay, it may have, typically a higher field spectrometer will be suitable for such a kind of a thing. Okay, and what is the information you want to derive from there? You want to study the full structure, or you only want to study the regions which are interacting, or you want to monitor the drug molecule which is interacting with that protein. You may not be interested in the protein per se, but the drug molecule which is binding to that one. So you can filter out that process. That is, see how the drug is binding. And there may be certain specific regions of the protein which are flexible. It may be producing a peak. First thing is to produce this protein in a recombinant manner. If you can produce the protein in a recombinant manner, then you get N15 labeled protein, N15 enriched. If you're enriched, then you have to record the HSQC spectrum, which I showed you. HSQC spectrum will produce you peaks for every residue, one peak for every residue. If they're all well resolved, you will get 100 KD corresponding to that. But typically, you may not get all of them well resolved. But there may be some which are well resolved. But you monitor the ones which are well resolved and study their interaction with the drug. So that will throw you light on the process of interaction.
Thank you, sir. I think that answers her question.
Okay.
Next question is by Shamukha Priya. She wants to know, while studying the interaction of Trifala, the one that you showed in the slide is a case study, with the GI, the gastrointestinal proteins, whether the interactions can be studied at multiple proteins at the same time? Is that possible?
That is a good question. Sure, you can do that. What you have to do is, therefore, you have to generate different kinds of mixtures. So here we showed with alpha-synuclein. Okay, now suppose there is another protein which is also involved. What you do is you label one protein and don't label the other protein in one case, and prepare a second sample where the other protein is labeled and this one is not labeled. Okay, so therefore you selectively pick up the signals from the labeled protein and monitor them individually. It may be interacting at both places. Therefore, when you do these experiments, you have prepared two kinds of samples. One is, suppose there is a protein A and a protein B, and you have a drug which is C or a Trifala, whatever the mixture that is. Okay. And then you have the protein A, protein B. You prepare two samples, A labeled, B unlabeled, and A unlabeled, B labeled. In both cases, you have to record the spectra with and without Trifala. Okay. Or the whatever drug you want to study. Then you study the interaction with the individual proteins. The drug may be interacting with both of them at the same time, but you monitor one of them at a time. So this will tell you if it is interacting with both of them, there is a quite possibility of synergy. You demonstrate the synergy of interaction. How this simultaneous binding to the both the things will help, and multiple pathways can be identified in this. That is how you study the different pathways, different metabolic pathways, the effect of these drugs on the different metabolic pathways.
Thank you, sir. I have two questions indeed, based on curiosity. When we study biological molecules, we know we have to perform sample preparations in water. That is mostly undeuterated waters to avoid the exchange rate.
Correct.
How do we take care of the overwhelming signals from water?
Oh, that is water suppression schemes are available. There are many water sufficient schemes. That is an integral part of every pulse sequence development now. All the spectra which I showed you, they are all in water. They are all in water, and there are pulse sequences that before you detect the signal, you introduce a small pulse sequence, which is called as a water gate or something, which will suppress the water signal. Then only you can detect the other ones. Otherwise, the dynamic range is too high.
Yes. The second question I had is, we have many, when we do FTIR by a spectrometer, we generally have phase issues and we have to correct them, which is quite straightforward in one-dimensional spectra. But how do you handle that in a higher-dimensional spectra?
No, here also this is possible. You have to take cross-sections. So typically, if your initial data point, T1 and T2 varies, which are there, if you start with the zero phase, that means zero delay, typically you don't need to phase correct. But sometimes you may not be able to start with the zero delay, and there will be small phase corrections, but you can take cross-sections and correct it and then apply through that.
Okay, sir. So I'll take one more last question. Dr. Chetali wants to know, can you tell us more about solid-state NMR and when this technique is used?
I did not talk about the solid-state NMR. This is typically used for those proteins which are insoluble. Insoluble and large ones which are insoluble proteins, like Alzheimer's. Okay, this Alzheimer's, all these plaques which are formed, and these you cannot study by solution-state NMR. These have to be studied by solid-state NMR. All these plaques and the membrane proteins. The membrane proteins, they are not soluble in water, but they are relevant in the membrane environment only. And therefore, in those cases, you can use solid-state NMR. But solid-state NMR, of course, is quite demanding in the sense that, okay, you will have to prepare many, many different kinds of samples. Specifically labeled, selectively labeled, because typically in solid-state NMR, the lines are very broad. Lines are extremely broad. And therefore, the effort is to reduce the line weights by using special techniques. The most common of them is called the magic angle spinning. Using the magic angle spinning, you reduce the dipolar coupling. Actually, sort of try to minimize the dipolar coupling, because the line widths in the solid-state NMR happen because of the dipolar coupling. Inhomogeneous line broadening. And this is suppressed by magic angle spinning. There are also other methods to suppress these dipolar couplings, but you also don't want to lose the information completely. So sometimes you selectively reintroduce this coupling in certain places to estimate the distances between certain groups. Therefore, there is a series of developments have happened in solid-state NMR from the point of view of, and the sensitivity issue is another important thing there. Sensitivity on solid-state NMR is much lower because of the large line weights. So you should try and improve the sensitivity there. And there are other techniques there which are used, like dynamic nuclear polarization, DNP, which are used to improve the signal-to-noise ratio in the solid-state NMR samples. But however, these ones are not yet applicable in the current routine use in the solution state. Those remained as model systems for demonstration purposes, but regular applications per se have not yet come in that. Some efforts are being made in that sense also to that.
Thank you, sir. We are still overwhelming with questions, but in interest of time, I will just take one more question. Yes. That is also by our coordinator, Dr. Premlata. She wants to know, while using the uniform, non-uniform sampling to enhance the rate of the experiment, how do we handle and sample multiple FIDs at a time?
No, these are collected individually only. The samples are collected individually, but there is a kind of an algorithm which will tell you how to collect the FIDs. There are multiple algorithms. There is a random algorithm, there is a Hilbert algorithm, there is some Poisson distribution. So that kind of distributions are there which will allow you to collect the data in a particular manner. And then you do a manipulation afterwards for the filling the remaining points. Okay, so you collect the data in certain number, but then you do arbitrary afterwards do algorithms to fill up those points which are not there. This comes from the trends. From the trends, you reintroduce those points. These various kinds of methods are present there. And after that, you do Fourier transformation. Therefore, you can do 10% non-uniform sampling, 10% sampling, 25% sampling. This depends on the resolution in the spectrum. If the resolution is very good, you can also do 10% sampling. If the resolution is rather poor, then you may want to do a little higher, 25% sampling. Nonetheless, it will still save a lot of time.
Thank you so much, sir. That answers well almost all the questions. Now I request our coordinator, Dr. Amre, to facilitate.
Okay,
Dr.
Thank you very much.
One hand raised, I can see.
Sorry?
Somebody has raised hands.
Madam, there are a couple of more questions, but I think we do not have enough time to take all of them.
Okay.
Planted by, what is this here? The name of the plant, Rose Botanical Garden, planted by Ms. Anish on behalf of the speaker. That's interesting.
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Thank you very, very much, sir.
Thank you so much.
Sir, we are truly grateful to you for sharing such a complicated topic in a lucid manner.
Thank you very much.
We extend our appreciation.
Yeah.
For your valuable time with a green token.
Thank you. So I did not take more time, right? I was in time.
No, perfectly, sir. That was just perfect.
And so we extend our appreciation for valuable time
Thank you.
So this is a e-certificate of appreciation. Please accept, sir, on behalf of Bombay College of Pharmacy.
Thank you very much, Dr. Premlata. Very nice. You are sending this by email to me or how it is?
Yes, sir. So we will be sharing this as well as your recordings.
Ah, good. Okay. That will be nice. So I can pass on this recorded thing to some others who want to listen to that leisurely. Sure. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All the best to you for the rest of the workshop. And
thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Have a nice day to you.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
So after this wonderful session, we will break for a short while. We resume at 11:15. But before we disperse, I have a short announcement for the participants. As per the AIC UTL guidelines, participants must obtain 80% attendance and 60% marks in the assessment test. We are also keeping a track of attendance during all the sessions and also via the feedback links. Feedback form links will be shared to all participants via email, WhatsApp chat, and in the chat box of the Teams at the end of every day, which is about 4 p.m. And the link will stop recording exactly at 5:30 p.m. Please ensure that you fill it within time. All participants will be given a chat option. In case you are not getting this chat option, please feel free to post on the WhatsApp chat as well. We will take up questions from there. We also wish to notify the participants that this is for the end of the day. So thank you. We will break for about 15 minutes now and we'll be back at 11:15. Thank you so much.